we're on our way stands now on our way to the Tower of London, which is here. This big old beastie. Helicopter or something overhead. Goodness. Had some bacon roll. It's just really ham and onions and on a bun. It was delicious. Alright, probably gonna see some crown jewel action. Oh yes. The royal arms and armor, that's what I'm after. Look, they have, let me zoom in on it, they have a trebuchet, which we're going to see up close and personal. Oh, sorry, zoom out. They have a trebuchet on display. That is so cool. Huh?
How are you?
Crazy birds.
I just want to be home.
It's the weather vane. There's that shard I think shot of earlier. Did you realize how dangerous that is? Big crowds. Fish and chips. Smell them. Saddens me. Miss out on fish and chips. Which I have thoroughly enjoyed so far, at least in Scotland. Huh? Not yet. There is something I want to get a shot of down there. Quite deep. Oh, that's awesome.
Observatory for observing the stars and
bird.
Welcome, I give you.
Hi there. Cool. Hey. These are
for you. You didn't call British.
Nope. Oh, hey. Is that made of like fence?
Chain link.
Chain link lions. That's super cool. Anyway. Oh.
Alright. Maybe take a picture of my hair.
We are.
Much closer now to the trebuchet.
I will down there with the trebuchet.
I'm sure.
So the past, you can head down on the right hand side as well.
Oh.
Enjoy your visit,
sir. No worries either way.
No, I don't know.
Okay. No back trip, grab a bag, flight, no back trip.
Sorry about that, guys. There's the woman. Ah. In 3 minutes. I want to look at this trebuchet. I want a picture with this trebuchet. Trebuchet.
Roll around, no gymnastics though. If you wait for the guided tour, you need to be in the moat, on the grass, that's it. By the little white sign there.
There you go. Close. A lot of folks.
The gross moat.
Boats were full of gross stuff back in the day.
You don't see that.
Oh, yes, I do. It is, but that's okay.
And you get a lot, like with Ash's camera.
Yeah.
Can't get near that much real estate in it.
Yeah. Well, it is. It's actually labeled wide on the front. But yeah. This tour starting here in a few minutes. That is amazingly good detail with that fencing stuff to make the lions. Crazy good. Checking out the people, having a good time. Everybody's having a good time.
Well, you've got to see the tour.
All right, so this is where Mary Queen of Scots was in prison for 19 years.
Pretty fancy
thing. But the big old prison she had run of the place.
I don't know if she had a run of the place or not.
Bloody crown.
I just want to see her.
Yeah.
Still plotting over the
room. Right, right. Yeah.
At least take Scotland.
Tour starts in a few minutes. I'm super pumped about it. I guess. The yeoman's all dressed up. And we're going to get started soon. Do our map has to tell us. Crown jewels, line of kings. coins and things. Yeoman water tours. It's a map.
Oh!
Fantastic. Okay. Where is the... Hey, there's a torture at the tower thing here.
That's 12:30.
Is there, is there an armory somewhere?
Right, come over here, guys.
All the folks.
Right, good afternoon, ladies and welcome to my 12-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-4-5-
to the top. About the next 45 minutes an hour or so, I'll be like, what we're going to do? Take a walk through it. We'll stop every now and then, point out the side buildings. I'm trying to tell you something, a little something, about them fascinating. So, right, so I'm talking to, so let's find out. I'm an Englishman, very proud of that fact. Hands up if you're English. Well, you've got nothing to worry about. You have a good day. Anyone here from Scotland? Well, you've got some coming, so pin your ears back. Anyone here from Australia? You on holiday or parole? Welcome home. Anyone here from New Zealand? That's sort of Australian, but honest, isn't it? Anyone here from America? I'm going to use a word called history. It will confuse you. You haven't got any. Just think, if you paid your taxes, all this would be yours. It's not. Anyone here from Canada? Oh, I'll leave you alone, like that. Everybody else has to go around, let me know where you're from. I do like to insult everybody. I don't like to leave anybody else. Right, storming into the year 1066. William the Duke of Normandy, William the Conqueror somehow. Don't ask me how he did. Being the Anglo-Saxon, how the sake of the Battle of Hastings, it will never happen again. William crowns himself, William the First of England on Christmas Day, that very same year, but he has to fight England, will not, like today, accept some Norman occupation. William needs a citadel. Needs to press this lot from London, so he chose this side to the east of the city where an old Roman fort would have stood. 1078, William ordered the building of his royal palace and fortress, first of its kind anywhere in England. William's palace is known as the White Tower. It stands at the very heart of this fortress. Don't overlook it, you can't see it from here. Just get in there and I'll show you where very shortly. 200 years past, we built three formidable lines of defence. Now look behind you, there are two walls. The furthest one away is the defensive wall built in 1220. 13 towers all the way around, all around defence. Closer one, outer defensive wall built in 1280. Six more towers, they all face south towards the river. Surrounding the entire fortress, we have the moat. The moat was built during the reign of King Edward I, designed by a man called Master Walter. Now he was Dutch, he was a master in the art of moat building. We bring him here from the Netherlands and he dug this moat for us. Originally, 120 foot wide, any water in here was about 18 foot deep with a dual purpose. Yeah, it's a live defence for Tower London. It's also the catchment area for all the filth and waste from the tower, and that included the tower toilets. If you excuse the expression, those 20 towers used to dump their filth, waste and excrement into the moat. Plan to get rid of it was quite simple. Twice there at high tide, we opened sluice gates. One in the east, that one there in the west. Once up, it allowed the tidal waters of the River Thames to wash around the moat, flushed all that filth and waste out into the river. Quite simply, it flows downstream across the channel and it was dumped in France. That's a marvellous piece of engineering. Is anyone here from France? Is anyone French? Yes? No, that's okay. There's no one here French. Right, the tide will now turn. We filled the boat. The there's a problem here. The Dutchman's got carried away with his shovel. He's dug the moat too deep. He dug the moat deeper than the river. Filth and waste never went to France. It just sank to the bottom. You're standing now in what, for 500 years, was the biggest stagnant cesspool in Europe. But the Tablander, it proved to be the biggest line of Paris. For some reason, no one ever tried to swim, fight, or wade their way through. But in 1843, that all changed. A great man called the Duke of Wellington, now he's consulate at the time, the Queen's represented here and over. Very, very close to Queen Victoria, said, Your Majesty, I need to drain the moat. She said, of course you can. And what you see here is the result. But look how green the grass is. 900 years that place has stood to be many different things. Some you may, some you may not know. Built as it's still today a royal palace. However, this is where the first royal observatory was established in 1675. That went to Greenwich. Greenwich it still stands today. Producing the storage of weapons and public records, it was even a mint. All the coins of our realm were designed and minted here until the year 1810. Behind me here used to be a royal menagerie, and there exotic animals are kept. Lions, tigers, bears, polar bears, baboons and elephants. They all wandered around the moat. Gifts to the kings of England. That's until the year 1832. Now, over 3 years, the animals all moved to Regent's Park. Still today, Regent's Park is London Zoo. So, animals long gone. Crown jewels, a different story. Crown jewels came within these walls in the year 1303. Ladies, trust me, they're still here for you to view today. Lastly, infamously, that became a state prison. Political and religious prisoners were held there. We'll chat about one or two of them as we wander around. For a very brief moment now, just forget the tar. Just glance at that building and continue above that wall. That building stands in the middle of what's known as Tower Hill. It's called Tower Hill for two reasons. One, it's a hill. Two, it's by the tower. Has anyone got a problem grasping that? Right outside of that is a park. You may walk through it to get here. It's called Trinity Gardens. Now on the floor in that park is a plaque. And that plaque has everything to do with the tower. That plaque marks the public execution site. Up there, no less than 75 men of noble birth who leave the tower now perish under the executioner's axe. First victim in 1381, Simon Sudbury, Archbishop of Canterbury. And he never got there. Outside the gates, he was ripped to pieces. He was torn limb from limb at the hands of the peasants. That man's crime, he invented the poll tax. He got what he deserved. 7 years later, 1388, the first beheading was that of Sir Simon Burley by sheer coincidence. Last man to die there, that's another Simon. Simon Fraser, Lord Lovett, 80-year-old Scottish lord. Yes, you're lost. Coming down here, causing trouble, upsetting the peace-loving English. However, he's the last man to die in Tower Hill in 1747. Train your minds to imagine 20 to 100,000 people on that hill. My job as a young warrior is to bring the condemned man out, but the gates give him to the Sheriff of London. Sheriff takes him to the scaffold. At the scaffold, he's face to face with his executioner. Now, very strange, the first thing he did, he forgave the executioner for what he's about to do. Then he pays him, piece of silver, even gold, in the hope the execution can be carried out in a clean cut manner. Kneel down, put your head onto a block of wood. The axe will now come, crunching down. The executioner steps forward. He picks up your severed and now bleeding head. Lays it high in the air and proclaim, behold, the head of a traitor. Die, all traitors, God save the king. Everybody watching went absolutely mad. Head, paled onto a soldier's pike, and off it goes to London Bridge. There it's left as a warning to all would-be traitors. Now you've got to trust me on this. London Bridge is that way. It's always been that way. That is Tower Bridge. They look nothing like each other. Who on earth could mix them up? Where's the Americans? Go to Arizona. The answer is directly. Very soon, the guys up the slope turn to the left in an archway into the Bywood Tower archway. As you go through, look above your heads, two things to see. First of all, the bomb spikes of a portcullis or Norman drop gate. Been up there since 1326, makes 1.5 turns, and one of two you'll see today. Also above your heads, three holes in the stonework known as murder holes. Originally put there so the people of Oakland dropped their waste into a cask. But when the tower's attacked, above those holes stand defenders. Now in their hands are buckets of things like hot oil, hot tar, and the contents of the moat, ready to dump down onto the heads of the attackers. Recycling is not a new concept. Let's wonder.